If there was anyone in the 1920s who challenged the popularity of Charles Lindbergh after he completed his transatlantic flight, it was Babe Ruth. Ruth changed the game of baseball forever, almost single-handedly, and became a celebrity equal to the most popular film stars of the day. But how did he manage to do this? Let's find out. George Herman Ruth Jr. was born into a working-class household in Baltimore, Maryland on February 6, 1895. His father owned and operated a saloon, which the family lived above. His parents weren't very attentive to their children, and his mother died in 1912 at the age of 38. Throughout his childhood, six of his siblings wouldn't survive infancy, and his only sibling was a sister, Mary, nicknamed Mamie, who was 5 years younger than him. He also developed bad habits at a very young age, chewing tobacco, smoking cigarettes, and drinking beer, all by the age of 8. As you can probably imagine from that last fact, Ruth was not a very responsible child, and freely admitted later to stealing and participating in other shenanigans when he was young. It's often speculated that this bad behavior was due to ADHD. It got so bad that his parents sent him to a strict Catholic school, St. Mary's. He would go in and out of the school, first staying for only a month in 1904, and then went again from 1910 to 1911. But his time at St. Mary's proved to be very influential for his future. It was really a turning point in his life. It was there that he met Brother Matthias, who Ruth probably regarded as more of a father than his own father. Brother Matthias was a big baseball fan, and he was able to hit a baseball a very, very long ways, which amazed the young Ruth. He quickly became involved with the school's baseball team, even advancing to the 16-year-old team when he was only 12. In 1913, Ruth played a game as a pitcher against another local Catholic school, and Jack Dunn, the owner of the minor league team, the Baltimore Orioles, offered the 18-year-old Ruth a contract for $600. Ruth proved himself to be a capable pitcher for the minor league team. One of his advantages as a pitcher was that he was left-handed, which was fairly uncommon at that time. And the fact that he was also good made him a force to be reckoned with on the mound. His salary quickly doubled to $1,200, then tripled from the original to $1,800. Despite his display of prowess, in a time when Major League Baseball didn't have massive crowds, almost nobody paid any attention to the minor league teams. Only about a dozen or two dozen onlookers showed up on average to a game. Nonetheless, the major league teams were always looking for prospective players in the minor leagues, and it didn't take too long before Ruth was noticed. Keep in mind that at this time, pitchers were still the most valuable players in the game, so this made Ruth desirable. However, he was still only seen as a player who had potential. Jack Dunn decided to sell his best players to raise money for another team, so he called his contact with the Boston Red Sox, who had lent Dunn money for the Orioles, and Ruth was accepted into the Red Sox along with two other teammates. In 1914, he played his first major league game only 5 hours after arriving in Boston, picking up his first win in the process. So within only a year of leaving St. Mary's, he had already shot up to the majors. Among other things, he quickly gained a reputation for having a massive appetite, often eating portions equal to three or four of his teammates. He was also still naive and often acted childish, which would persist throughout his career. But for his fans, this only made him more endearing to them. Before being given the nickname Babe, his teammates called him the Big Baboon, which he detested. He was also sometimes called the N-word from the dugouts, which infuriated him, especially since it was taken as a slight on his working-class upbringing. The nickname Babe had a more positive connotation, reflecting his endearing childish behavior, and it eventually stuck. Babe Ruth hit his first home run on May 6, 1915, and then just kept hitting more. Not only were there many, they were extremely long for the day, setting unofficial distance records. This was, and still is, very unusual. An ace pitcher also being a home run machine was almost unbelievable. And with the home runs came bigger crowds. But in the 1915 World Series, he wasn't put in to pitch for reasons that aren't completely clear. He was sent in to pinch hit once, only to ground out to first. The next season, 1916, Ruth's statistics would only improve, and his salary would be bumped up to $5,000. Amid all this initial success, Ruth also saw his first ejection from a game. After being dissatisfied with the umpire's calls, he got into a heated argument and was thrown out. Ruth charged the umpire and punched him to the ground. This earned him a week suspension and a $100 fine. It was only until 1919 that Ruth's full potential was unleashed. He had been unsatisfied with the role of pitcher because it meant that he only appeared once in every five games. Eventually, he was given a position in the outfield as a regular player, and then the home runs really started to roll in. Then began his long habit of breaking records, surpassing the single-season home run record of 27, replacing it with 29. But then there was a big change for Babe Ruth the following year. The owner of the Red Sox, Harry Frazee, needed money for reasons that are still not completely clear, and decided to sell Ruth to the New York Yankees in 1920. In retrospect, it is considered one of the most significant trades in the history of baseball, but at the time, opinion was split. But within a short time, Red Sox fans would be kicking themselves at the thought of losing Babe Ruth. The 1920 season was truly a game changer. In his first year with the Yankees, Babe Ruth would smash his own record of 29, replacing it with a whopping 54. Then he would break his record again the next year with 59 home runs. This is generally considered the real beginning of the popularity of power hitting in the major leagues, a trend that continues to this day. Ruth had had the ability all along, and now that he was a regular player instead of a pitcher, he could really let loose with the bat. Fans were in awe of this new development, and attendance skyrocketed at the Polo Grounds. Suddenly, home run hitters were the new trend, and other teams fumbled to get their own Babe Ruth. 1922 saw continued success, as well as a temporary suspension along with two other teammates, issued from the Commissioner of Baseball Kennesaw Mountain Landis for playing informal exhibition games, which was against MLB rules. But Babe Ruth was still doing fine for himself, earning an unheard of $52,000 that season. This was more than double the salary leader of 1921, Ty Cobb, who had made only $25,000. Ruth's salary in 1922 made up 40% of the collective salary of the entire New York Yankees, and he would continue to be the highest paid baseball player for the next 12 years. But the success was taking its toll. Ruth had been widely known for his lifestyle of indulging in food, drink, and women to excess. In 1922, he had weighed 210 pounds, but around 2 years later, he had ballooned to 260 pounds, and it was during this time that he became very sick. We still don't know the exact cause of his illness, but he was found unconscious in his hotel room, prompting rumors about his death. He spent much of the 1925 season on the bench arresting, hitting only 25 home runs and 98 games played, though I want to mention that this was still only two short of the previous single-season home run record which he had broken in 1919. But Babe Ruth would recover, and he was fit and ready for the next season. Ruth regained his stride, smacking 47 home runs that season. That World Series also contributed to the legend of Babe Ruth significantly. After promising a sick boy in a hospital that he would hit a home run for him, he did, which made him appear to have a godlike status for his already adoring fans. He also hit 3 home runs in a single World Series game, the first time that had ever happened. But the 1927 season would be one of the most important seasons for Ruth, and for baseball in general. The 1927 Yankees is considered to be the best team ever assembled in the game of baseball, and for good reason. It was a real demonstration of how the game had changed so much in so little time. The first 6 batters in the lineup, including Babe Ruth and a young Lou Gehrig, were all power hitters. This was dubbed Murderer's Row for its ruthlessness at the plate. Compare that with a modern setup, where usually only the 3rd and 4th batters are power hitters. Though Babe Ruth was still by far the dominating hitter. Of the 158 total home runs for the team, he hit 60 of them. This was yet another single-season home run record. He was barely able to beat his previous record of 59 from the 1921 season, but that new record would stand for 34 years, until it was broken by a single home run by Roger Maris in 1961. The Yankees took home 110 wins that season, a team record that wouldn't be broken until 1998. The 1927 season proved extra exciting for fans due to the home run battle between Gehrig and Ruth, in which Gehrig briefly gained the upper hand. But this competition was all friendly sport. The 1927 season would be the peak of Babe Ruth's career. Keep in mind that by this time, he was 32 years old, which is very late for a peaking career as it was. He would still hit 54 home runs the next season, but he was beginning to slow down. This was probably due to his old habits creeping up on him again. After getting back in shape a couple of years ago, he went back to his hedonistic lifestyle, drinking heavily, eating enormous amounts of unhealthy food, and smoking cigars. By 1929, things were going downhill steadily. The Yankees' legendary manager and Ruth's on-field motivator, Miller Huggins, died suddenly. And here, at the end of the 20s, Babe Ruth's career was not yet over, but it was beginning to show serious signs of decline. Here's a quick epilogue to his legendary 1920s career. His legend still continued. 1930 saw the famous called shot, which caused a sensation then and is still talked about even now. And his salary was still higher than even President Hoover's. But really, things were coming to an end for Babe Ruth. This can be seen in his home run output for the remainder of his career. In 1930, he hit 49 home runs, then 46 the following year, still leading the MLB. Then he dropped to 41, then 34, then 22. In his last season in 1935, playing for the Boston Braves, he hit a measly 6 home runs. Though to be fair, he only appeared in 28 games. But by then, he was so physically out of shape that it was severely affecting his playing ability. He had only been brought onto the Braves as an attraction to get a bigger audience for games. He knew it was time to retire, and he did. He tried desperately to get a managing or coaching position, but despite being the legendary player that he was, no one would take him on. He would briefly work as first base coach for the Brooklyn Dodgers in 1938, during which he would win a slugging contest. He was one of the first 5 players to be inducted into the Baseball Hall of Fame in 1936, and attended the official opening in 1939. That same year, he would speak at Yankee Stadium on Lou Gehrig Appreciation Day, when Gehrig announced his retirement due to his battle with ALS. And Ruth continued to feel disheartened because he could not participate in the game of baseball anymore. His lack of control and reckless lifestyle are often cited as reasons for not receiving any offers for management positions. He was depressed because he wasn't able to do what he loved most. In 1946, it was discovered that Ruth had throat cancer, and it was eventually deemed inoperable. Despite new innovations in cancer treatment, it didn't work, and he lost 80 pounds in 3 months. After a brief glimmer of hope, his condition continued to deteriorate rapidly. On June 13, 1948, Ruth visited Yankee Stadium one final time, looking extremely frail. The speech he gave is heartbreaking not for its contents, but for the way this once strong and powerful man now sounded when he spoke, knowing that he is quickly dying. He would die only 2 months later on August 16th. Babe Ruth was one of the greatest baseball players of all time. From 1918 to 1931, he led the major leagues in home runs in all but 2 years, 1922 and 1925. In his career, he hit 714 home runs, a record that would stand for 30 years until Hank Aaron overtook it in 1974. But keep in mind that he was a pitcher for the first few years of his career and played only 1 in every 5 games at that time. And he had that illness in 1925 that benched him for most of the season. To think of how many home runs he could have hit without these obstacles is incredible. He would also be the league leader of walks for most of his career after he joined the Yankees in 1920, because pitchers were afraid to pitch to him. In short, Babe Ruth was the best baseball player in his time, and is still one of the best of all time. He was truly a larger-than-life figure who changed the game of baseball forever. His popularity in the late 1920s rivaled even Charles Lindbergh, though they couldn't have been more different. While Lindbergh was stiff, quiet, and conservative, Babe Ruth was brash, led an eccentric lifestyle, and basked in his fame. He was a different kind of role model, to say the least. Not only was he a good player, he was relatable as a person. He was coarse, irreverent, a lovable man-child with a massive appetite. He had a temper that sometimes got him into trouble and terrible personal habits, but the public loved him for that. It was almost like he was one of them. He had gone through a difficult upbringing to become easily one of the most recognizable people in America. He gave hope to young boys across the country that they could one day achieve something as great as Babe Ruth. He was their hero, and that is really his greatest legacy. I had to do a lot of research for this video, so I really hope you enjoyed it. Babe Ruth was adored by the public and remains an enduring celebrity of the 1920s, so I've really been wanting to make this video for a long time, and I'm glad I finally did. For more videos about everything 1920s, please consider subscribing to my channel for more videos. Well, that's all for now, all you geeks and gals out there, but stay tuned for more tales from the Jazz Age.